Yippee! Meeting success, F-R-I-P-P. Who do you call when you are the best? F-R-I-P-P. She's fabulous!
She's remarkable!
Inspiring!
Profound!
Powerful! Who do you call when you want success? F-R-I-P-P. F-R-I-P-P.
How many life-changing, career-building, or inspiring presentations have you heard or given? Probably not that many. Don't worry. Learning to be an effective communicator probably isn't as difficult as what it is you now do. It's just, whereas you focused on your profession for the last 20 plus years, I've been focusing on how to design and deliver charismatic messages. So let's look at the basic principles that can help you become a much more effective presenter. And when we talk about presentations, it doesn't matter what it is you define a presentation as. It could be a speech, a sermon, a sales presentation, run a staff meeting. It could be standing up or sitting down at a boardroom table. Many of the principles work exactly the same, whatever the venue is that you will be speaking in. I guarantee once you master the skills, you will seek out every opportunity, even if you don't believe it right now. There are three ingredients that go into every presentation, formal or informal. They are the structure, content, and delivery. The structure is how you organize your remarks and put them together. The content is what it is you say, and the delivery, of course, is how you say it. And I maintain, if you do not know what you are going to say and have it organized in a logical way, it's very difficult for you to remember and also the audience. There are two ways that you need to connect to your audience, be it one or 1,000, intellectual and emotional. Obviously, you are going to intellectually connect through your content. However, to be a successful and persuasive speaker, you need to connect emotionally. And there are three ways you can emotionally connect to your audience. The first is eye contact. You actually look at the audience and communicate. So let's imagine you are around a boardroom table and there are five other individuals. You look at those individuals for a thought, an idea, or a phrase. So if you just scan them or look above their heads, you will not make a connection. And there is a level that they do not feel that you are sincere, that you're trustworthy, or that you're confident. Remember, it doesn't matter how you feel. And it would be unnatural to not be nervous in many circumstances. It is what is the world seeing? And a good exercise for you, and practice this with your friends or with your family, get your friends to sit around the table and put their arm like this. And you look at them, don't say anything. You look at them one at a time and count to five. One, two, three, four, five. Remember, at this point, don't care about the words. And when you have made eye communication for the 5 seconds, they can put their hand down. Now the exercise, and I do this in classes all the time, is you go around and first of all communicate for the thought, the idea, or the phrase. That is eye contact. Now let's imagine you're with a larger audience. Walk out and deliver the opening line to one person for the whole phrase or sentence. I gave a seminar at the church that I attend, and the minister, who's a great speaker, said he came out and delivered the first line of his sermon to one person. And he said, Patricia, after that, I never had as many people stand in line, shake hands, and say you were talking just to me. So the first way you emotionally connect with your audience is through eye contact. The second way you emotionally connect is what I call the high I-you ratio. This is a matter of speak as an audience advocate. If you look at what is it you actually say and see where you can put the audience's point of view into it. For example, I will not stand and say to an audience, I am going to teach you how to be a better speaker. I would say, in the next 3 hours, you will learn how to be a more effective speaker. Because every audience has a responsibility. I know the information they attended as you invested in this learning system so that you can learn. So you will learn rather than I will say. Practice this with your one-on-one conversations. Look at the difference between Mary, I had a great time at your party, compared to Mary, you are a magnificent host. You know how to make your guests feel special like nobody else. And as we go through this learning system, you'll find there are many ways that you can use the I-U ratio. At the beginning of a presentation, and you will find out the first 30 seconds are the most important, it could be, have you ever experienced, or you know what it's like when, or I don't know what advice your father gave you, but when I was growing up, my dad always said. And once you get in the habit of focusing your remarks on the other person, you will always have an emotional connection. Work on the principle that your audience, be it 1, 10, 100, or 1,000, is more interested in them than you. Focus on them, and you'll never go wrong. And the third way you emotionally connect with an audience is through stories. Naturally, to be a great speaker, you have to develop good storytelling techniques. And we will focus a lot in this series. If you think back to when you were a child, what did your parents say? Clean your teeth, get in your jammies, get into bed, and mummy or daddy will come tell you a story. Whenever you launch into a story or a case history or an example, subliminally, your audience is thinking, oh, this is a treat. Also, there is no better way to explain the complex or to train through using stories. Also, if you're a sales professional, let's face it, third-person endorsement stories, examples of satisfied clients, are a great way to connect and also be memorable. Let's not forget, when you speak, whether it's for 2 minutes, 5 minutes, an hour, or 4 days, you speak to be remembered and repeated. And using stories, people won't remember everything you say. They will always remember the picture you create in their mind. The most difficult one sentence of any presentation is the premise. Think about what is it you want to say in one sentence. It may be the title of your presentation. However, it might just be for your preparation. Let's look at what the dictionary definition of a premise is. A premise is a proposition, supposed or proved, a basis of argument. Another definition is a proposition stated or assumed as leading to a conclusion. So if you think with your premise, what is it you want to say, and then how are you going to prove it? There are different ways that you can look at the premise. It could be the central theme, your big idea. And when you're putting together your presentation, it's what are you passionate about? Now I frequently ask, Patricia, what if you don't care about your subject? Well, you have to find something about it that you can be excited with. This is your Fripper size. Think about what is it you want to state? What would your premise be? The central theme, remember, the big idea. And can you write it in a way that would make the audience think how or why? A couple of examples. I delivered a presentation to Treasury professionals. The title of the speech was Selling Yourself and Your Ideas to Your Upper Management. So the premise, and in this case I actually stated it, every treasury professional can sell themselves and their ideas to their upper management. That would lead to the question, how? And that becomes the talking points which build the framework of the argument or presentation. Another example. I was hired to speak to 350 Seventh-day Adventist pastors. It was a four-hour program at the end of a conference. And let's face it, nobody needs to be at a conference for more than 3 days. Always look at what it is that you are saying from the point of view of the audience. So if you were a pastor, reading in the program, day four, Patricia Fripp, How to Design and Deliver a More Charismatic Sermon, what would you be thinking? I bet you'd think, huh, she's the only person on the program for 4 days who isn't a minister. How can anyone who isn't a minister tell me how to write a better sermon? I write a new one every week. I bet she isn't even a Seventh-day Adventist. Which I'm not. So you realize by introducing the premise fairly early in the presentation, you can in fact connect to the audience and prove perhaps you have something of value. My premise in that case was every Seventh-day Adventist pastor and lay preacher can deliver even more charismatic sermons. Again, they would think, how? By better understanding and implementing the three necessary ingredients that go into every effective sermon. What are they? The structure, the content, and delivery. You have to connect with your congregation two ways. What are they? Intellectually and emotionally. There are three ways you emotionally connect with your congregation. What are they? Eye contact, IU ratio, and stories. You see how it works. This is how you build a logical, organized presentation. And once you have that premise written in a way that leads to how or why, you literally can build the framework of your presentation. So let's look at the Fripp structure of how to put together your remarks. In this very simple diagram that you have, you can see what a speech looks like. As you can see, this is the Fripp model of a presentation. And when you're using these techniques, it's better to start with something simple. Put together a 20 or 30 minute presentation using these principles. You can always get more complex after. The circle at the top stands for the first 30 seconds. Come out punching. Grab the audience's attention. And the last 30 seconds, the circle at the bottom, represents the end of the presentation. Every Las Vegas performer will tell you they start and close their set with their best songs. And that's what I want you to do with your presentation. I don't care if you're leading a staff meeting, giving a sales presentation, or a speech to your Rotary Club, or to a convention audience. The first 30 seconds and the last 30 seconds have the most impact. Then you'll see, answer the questions that the audience have in their minds. What would they be thinking about based on your introduction, based on perhaps what the write-up was in the program, or if it's a sales presentation, you know what it is they're expecting you to prove in your presentation. Then, of course, there's the premise. And I believe you might collect all the stories, the ideas, the thoughts, the key points you want to put in your presentation. They might be on a flip chart, on a pad. However, once you write the premise, everything falls into place. Because the talking points, what I call the points of wisdom, are the talking points to prove your premise. The circles stand for the stories, ideas, case histories, statistics, and don't forget, at the end of every chunk of material, think, what do you want the audience to do with that information? Then you will see between each chunk of material a seamless transition. A seamless transition can simply be silence. Or you might move on transition to a different part of the stage. So with each talking point, point of wisdom, the circles stand for the information that you use to go around that talking point. If it's a fairly short presentation, perhaps 20 or 30 minutes, then of course at the end you're going to do a review, and then you would say, before my closing remarks, are there any questions? Never close on questions. And that is one of the biggest mistakes I find many business speakers make. Look at it this way. You want to close on a high, and you might want to think about this. Last words linger, and you want them to be yours. What if one of the questions is controversial or negative? You don't want to end your presentation with the feeling in the audience of that negative thought. You want to close on a high. And that is a simple formula, and you cannot go wrong using it. Many of my clients say, Patricia, we don't even let our direct reports come in till they've filled in their Fripp diagram. It's just a matter of focusing your thinking, even with an important conversation, or perhaps a telephone conversation with an important client. So again, your premise, one sentence, what is it you're going to say? Can you write it in a way that leads to how or why, which becomes the points of wisdom? And then how are you going to illustrate and make your points of wisdom come alive? Don't close on questions. Close on last words that linger. And don't worry, we'll give you more options. To make this more fun for you, every so often we're going to insert some segments from live presentations, and so you can see how these points are illustrated in real life. In fact, let's look at a segment from a Toastmaster presentation. This was when I was the opening general session speaker at an international Toastmaster conference, and you can see about answering the questions the audience would have in their mind. Then you're going to see how my next door neighbor, Mike Powell, took these simple instructions that you've just heard on how to put together a presentation and used to design his first presentation that he gave to a lay audience, because he was a scientist, not used to talking to real people. Let me tell you about my next door neighbor, Mike Powell. Mike Powell was a senior scientist at Genentech. And I said, Mike, I know you're not used to talking to real people. You talk to scientists. But if you come and speak to my Continental Breakfast Club about the work you're doing developing an AIDS vaccine, I'll help you with your speech. I won't write it, but I'll help you. And I gave him the same instructions I just gave you. This is what he did with it. I said, Mike, come out punching, grab the audience. He walked out and said, this audience is very different than it was 5 years ago because of the scare of AIDS. I said, answer the questions the audience have in their mind. Most people don't hang out with scientists. And even if they do, they have no idea what they're talking about. Tell them, what is it like to be a scientist? He said, being a scientist is like doing a jigsaw puzzle in a snowstorm at night. When you don't have all the pieces and you don't have the picture you're trying to create. I defy you to come up with a one-sentence description that would describe the frustration of your job as well. I said, Mike, in a 25-minute speech, you're probably going to make 3 points. But remember, people won't remember what you say, they will remember what they see. So describe, give a story so people can see it. He was talking about the difference between AIDS and cancer.
He said, imagine AIDS is a green jacket and cancer is a red jacket. In the Q&A portion, people were saying, well, if you're a green jacket, you see what he did? He took a highly complicated subject and spoke to a lay audience in a way they understood well enough to ask questions. Because if they can't, what he was probably was trying to intellectually connect with the PhDs in the crowd and speak over the head of most people. He was talking about DNA. Now, this was before the O.J. Simpson trial, so we now know a lot about DNA. He said, imagine you have a store and a thief comes in and grabs something off the rack and runs out and you run after him. And you catch up to him, you grab his shirt, but he keeps running, but you have the shirt. We could see the shirt. And he was talking about the perspiration on the collar could give clues how you could track down the thief. So after his 3 points, he said, are there any questions before my closing remarks? You always do your questions because you want to close on your own high. The biggest mistake I see with business presentations is people finish on questions.
As you heard, the way you open a presentation is most important, and you have many theatrical choices. The first and one of my all-time favorite ways to open a presentation is with a very interesting and compelling story. If perhaps you are making a major point, if you can have that point within the story that you open, then when you pull out your premise, it becomes obvious. In fact, why don't we watch a segment from my Toastmaster speech where I introduce four different ways you can open. You'll hear story is one of them.
How about four different ways you can open the speech? What I opened with was a statement. It never ceases to amaze me. One of the most dramatic statements I ever heard 5 years ago, I was speaking for Young Presidents Organization. One of the other speakers, Newt Gingrich, walks out. Forget politics, it was a heck of an opening. 5 years later, I remember exactly what he said without writing it down. He walked out and said, if you were born today, you would already owe $186,000 to pay your share of the national debt. Wow. But again, I challenge you. An audience that heard you speak 5 years ago, would they remember your opening? How about opening with a quote? As the great philosopher Raquel Welch said, style is being yourself, but on purpose. And every time you stand up to address an audience, you have to be yourself, but slightly larger than life, in other words, on purpose. Now, will you notice by opening with a quote, what I did not do was say, I would like to start my speech with a quote. And I am going to quote a movie star for dramatic comic effect. No. Just tell them the quote. Just do it. Edit the nub. You could start with a bold claim. In the next 45 minutes, I'm going to teach you more about speaking than you could learn in a college course. If you start your speech with a bold claim, make sure you can follow through. Don't promise something you can't do. And how about, of course, one of the favorite ways to start a speech is with a story. But the story always has to tie into what are you talking about, you or the situation that you're in.
The second way to open a presentation could be a powerful quotation. However, you don't want it to be overused. I am well known for saying, don't keep quoting dead white men. Now, it doesn't mean that dead white men, Ralph Waldo Emerson, Abraham Lincoln, John Kennedy, they certainly said magnificent words worth repeating. However, the problem is, if you start a presentation with a quotation that absolutely everybody in the audience is familiar with, even if it makes a good point, it has a tendency to flavor what comes next as not being original and leading edge. So if you have that great quote that is well known, that will make your point, certainly use it, just don't use it at the opening. Look within your life for something that is real for you. Perfect example, a gentleman called Gene Hampton at ADP, when I was doing a lot of sales presentation skills. He happened to be in college a caddy for Jack Welch. Can you believe that luck? And in Jack Welch's book, it talks about the power of outsourcing. Well, ADP outsources payroll. So, of course, when Gene started his presentation with, as a young man at college, I was a caddy for Jack Welch. And in his book, I was excited to read and then give the quote. That was something that was so pertinent and different. You start with something that is unexpected. One of my favorites when I'm talking about presentation skills is, as the great philosopher Raquel Welch said, style is being yourself, but on purpose. In other words, every time you stand up in front of an audience, you have to be yourself, however, a little more on purpose. And then a question is a way to start a presentation. However, I hate personally the speakers are saying, raise your hand if you want to make more money. I would rather you ask that question more rhetorically. If I were to ask you, is this the year you're committed to make more money? Something like that. The fourth way that you can open a presentation is an interesting statistic or little known fact. Years ago, I was speaking for Young Presidents Organization at the Ritz-Carlton in Buckhead. And one of the other speakers was Newt Gingrich. I don't care if you don't even like him. When you heard this opening, wow, he walked out and said, if you were born today, you would already owe $186,000 to pay off your share of the national debt. That was certainly an interesting statistic and a little known fact. However, look at its high IU ratio. If you were born today, you would already owe $186,000 to pay off your share of the national debt. Let's look at an interesting way you can use a story to start your presentation from a live presentation. Here I am talking about a real life situation. This was in my Toastmaster opening speech.
I hope you like conferences as much as I do. Of course, I spend my life at them. A few years ago, 27 other speakers and myself in San Diego for a meeting. After the meeting, we go out to dinner, and after dinner, we decide we'd like ice cream. So we turn up at Baskin-Robbins exactly 9 p.m. when the manager was turning around the closed sign. Well, you could tell he was the manager, 16 years old, little white jacket and a cap. One of my pals gets out, knocks on doors, says, excuse me, 28 people for ice cream, 10 minutes work. Kid says, sir, we've closed. My friend looks through the glass door, sees two other kids, thinks, well, three kids working for minimum wage, I'll make them an offer. He said, $30 for you three and the sale of 28 ice creams. They huddle. A focus group to study the problem. The kid comes back and said, could you make it $40? We settle for 30, but being sales trainers, we really appreciated that he tried to get more. Because that young man realized two things I don't want you to ever forget. One, life is a series of sales situations. And two, the answer is no if you don't ask. And we are here this evening selling you on the concept that even the most dedicated Toastmasters can be even more effective in preparing and presenting powerful programs.
Another opening option if you're speaking at a conference or convention is to tie into the theme. If you just walked out and said, "I love your theme," and then tell them why, you would make points. In fact, I remember when I worked for Texas Instruments and Sterling Software. I walked out and said, "I love your theme, your connection to the future with Texas Instruments and Sterling Software." You will never go wrong mentioning your sponsors and their theme, because a committee spent about 4 months coming up with it, and very often after the general session, nobody mentions it. When I coach a whole team, and very often I do coach everybody who's going to present at the convention, I make sure that somewhere in their program, whether it's a keynote or a breakout or emceeing a panel, they do something to tie into the theme. The next option of opening, "So What, Me Too," I learned from Jim Rohn, the magnificent and great motivational speaker. In 1975, I used to go once a month to San Jose to hear the same seminar with Jim Rohn. Can you imagine my excitement in 1992 to go on a 2-week speaking tour of Australia with Jim Rohn? And one day he said to me, "Patricia, after you're introduced with this great introduction, the audience is thinking, so what? You want them to think, me too." And the best example I ever saw of that was with Lou Dobbs, again at that same conference, Young Presidents Organization. Let's listen to how I tell that story at the Toastmaster International presentation.
The audience is thinking, so what? You want them to think, me too. And the best example I've ever seen of an audience connecting with a speaker, or the speaker connecting with the audience right front, was again at this Young Presidents Organization. One of the other speakers, Lou Dobbs from Moneyline CNN. And they introduced him. He'd won this award. He'd done this, been on television. Very, very impressive. The audience was very impressed in themselves. Very young, very successful. The typical group that would be thinking, so what? He walked up and he said, "John, did not tell you one award that I won last year. The local Chamber of Commerce named me Father of the Year. They had this fabulous event, gave me the plaque, I gave a speech. And afterwards I went home and my family were sitting down having dinner. I sat down and my son said, Dad, who actually voted on this award?" See, the essence was, it doesn't matter how famous we are, how well-known we are, we will never get the respect from our teenagers we think we deserve. He had such a great connection. It was perfect. So answer the questions. Think, what would they want to know?
Another option for an opening is start with the recommendation first. And that is very good with business presentations. If you are reporting to your senior level management, or if you're giving a sales presentation to their executives, get to the point fast. Their favorite expression is, "What is the bottom line?" And you need to report on your recommendations. You handle the details, but you report on the deals. So you might walk out and say something. It was a privilege being in charge of chairing the cross-functional team to study if the ABC company should invest in diversity training. Our 36-member committee recommends yes. We have research. I mean, get to the point. That's it. Another way you can open a presentation very effectively is what I call transport the audience into the future by using the word imagine. Let us just say you want to sell a vision or a product, and you are in a room talking to an audience on April the 18th, 2006. If you walked out and said, imagine, it is April the 18th, 2007. And as you get dressed, you take a moment to reflect that the last year of your life has been the most incredible. You've never been as happy, got along with the people you live with, and had so many satisfied clients. You've never made as much money, and you look out and see your brand new car and look forward to visiting your vacation home. Will that picture be a reality? I don't know. It all depends on the action you take after hearing a presentation on April the 18th, 2006. So you paint a picture of the future, and then you come back to now and go ahead with the presentation. Then at the end, you might say, do you want to project the positive image that we imagined at the beginning of the presentation? It all depends on what you do based on and you review your talking points. So you see, it's all theatrical points. There are no right or wrong. You pick what's right for you. So if you think of what would your presentation be about that you want to use these principles, what is your premise? Now, how do you think at this point, what would be your opening? Most people are fine once they get going with their presentations, but they really have a problem with the beginning. So you now have oodles of options, of phrases that you can use to transition into what it is you're going to say. Now, I'm not suggesting you use them all, but what you might like to do is just say some of them to yourself and just see what naturally follows. I wish you could have been there. It was one of the most exciting days of my life. It was one of the scariest moments of my life. It wasn't exactly what I expected. Now, let me show you how I actually used that line as an opening of a presentation. I'm talking about an experience I had in South Africa. The speech is called How to Position Yourself Ahead of the Crowd, or How to Sell Yourself and Your Ideas to Your Upper Management. So imagine you're in a convention hall. I walk out and say, it's not exactly what I expected. Oh, it certainly was a great adventure. I didn't get paid as much as I usually do. However, some of the best rewards in life are not necessarily financial. In 1992, I was speaking in South Africa. On one weekend, they took us to a game park. It's not at all like a zoo. And we went out to see these magnificent animals. We saw the rhinos and the giraffes and the elephants and the zebras and the ostrich. Felt a little guilty about the ostrich. We'd eaten one of his relations the night before. And what I found fascinating was when these animals stood perfectly still, you couldn't see them. They were camouflaged. That didn't surprise me with something grey like an elephant or a rhino, but it was surprising with something as distinctive as a zebra or giraffe. And on reflection, I realized what keeps those animals alive in their jungle will get us eaten alive in ours. Because at times, it might be appropriate to fade into the background. However, in general, we need to stand out, be memorable and distinctive. if we are going to sell ourselves to our upper management. Can you see you take the idea and then you flow into the premise? Another fabulous Fripp opening that you might use and try is, what would the world be like without? Now you fill in the blank. I used this at the American Payroll Association Congress, their meeting of 2,000 members, and their theme that year was around television. My speech was about the history of television. My opening line was, what would the world be like without television? Develop my speech around the history of television, etc. And then, of course, at the end, I tied in my clothes around, and what would the world be like without the American Payroll Association? More Fripp fabulous openings. If I were to ask you, who would have ever thought? Remember the good old days when? I use that with the presentation, remember the good old days when it was more important to be compatible with your spouse than your computer. So you're talking about a time before technology. More fabulous Fripp openings? It was just one of those days. In fact, that was the opening that Ed Tate used in his presentation that won him the 2000 Toastmaster International World Champion speech. With that opening, didn't you want to hear about his day? Then there are other Fripp openings. At the time, I would never have considered. Or, I wish you could have been there. That is another technique to transport the audience to a different time and place. Why not try some of these openings? Let's go back to, I'll never forget the time when. There I was, my very first day, in this company, in this country, wherever you want to go. If you had been there, sitting in the front row of the David Freeman screenwriting seminar, you would have heard. That is a great opening, or a great transition into talking about an experience you had, but again, you're transporting the audience, you're taking them with you, so it's a much more effective way than saying, I was there taking this screenwriting seminar and I learned this. How about trying, what an exciting day, what a great time, just something to foreshadow the energy of what it is you're going to talk about. Remember, the importance of emotionally connecting is to have a high IU ratio. And most salespeople stand up and say, I am here to talk about the ABC company. Much better to say, you have an awesome responsibility. Your board of directors has charged you to. Again, focus on the other person. Let's imagine you are talking to an audience or selling to a client, and there was a time that you had their job. So you could start with, just like you, there was a time when I. You could open a presentation straight to the point, and before we consider what action you are going to take around your technology, let's look at. So again, tight openings, getting to the point, and focusing on the audience. Other options, on a personal note, come back with me. I can't believe I did. Imagine. These are just suggestions on how you can get started. If you had ever asked me, let's go on a journey. Let's start with a history lesson. The year was. Suddenly, everything fell into place. As I was growing up, my dad, grandmother, minister, always told me. And in case you think, surely she's given me enough, here are a few more. You know what it's like when. Have you ever had the feeling that? Come back with me too. I'll never forget the first time. So how do you close your speech on a high. You have a great opening, you have a clear premise, you have a strong structure, you have talking points, you've done your review, you've done a call for action, or you should. You need to end with some sort of challenge. What is it you want the audience to do? And then one technique that I often use is I use my name, Fripp, as an acronym to close. I often say, I hope you remember me, because after all, I'm unemployed when I finished a speech until I create another. However, much more important, remember what Fripp stands for. Frequently reinforce ideas that are productive and profitable. I was delivering a seminar at the National Speakers Association headquarters, and I mentioned this technique, and the young woman who followed me said, I think that's a great idea, Patricia. However, I don't know how I could do this with Hershkowitz. And would you believe, a speaker got up later and had made an acronym out of her name, Hershkowitz. That was not that easy to do. So let's look at some other ideas to close on a high. As you've already heard, your last words linger. So just whereas I would encourage you to script the first few sentences of how you open, just so you can learn it, not so you'd read it, I would encourage you to also script the close so you can read it and edit it. And then perhaps you want to finish the end of the story. What is very effective is perhaps tell a story at the beginning of your presentation, which does end with a resolution. However, even though it's a satisfying experience and the audience feels like it's finished, you really pick it up again at the end with the closing part of the story. My friend Tony Alexander does a great job with this technique. I saw him open a speech telling a story about trying to buy an airline ticket. And he went back the next day to actually book it, and it was 6 times as much money. And he calls the airlines, and the woman says, well, I can't do anything for you. You're going to have to pay the fee, or you're going to have to talk to the president. And then he goes on with his presentation on customer service, and then at the end, just when he's summed up his points, he says, so I called the president and said, and it was so funny and it was so unexpected. And then you can close by circling with your opening thought. I tell all my clients and all my students, when you are thinking of closing your presentation, at least go back to the opening to see what it was you said to tie it in. And let's go to my Toastmaster speech to see that done very effectively.
And then I said, in a perfect world, you can perhaps tie the open into the close in a circle. This is what he did. I was so proud of him. Please remember, this was the first speech he ever gave to a lay audience. He said, at the beginning of my talk, I told you the frustration of being a scientist. So many people ask, why would you do it? Last story. 2 steps forward on silence for effect. You only do it once or twice, or it looks like a technique. Because as Laurence Olivier said, the art is hiding the art. Miami, Florida, July 1994. Fourth day of a medical conference, 3:30 in the afternoon. We've been in the same hot room since 7:30 in the morning. The last speaker, a young woman, walked from the back of the room. She went to the lectern and said, I am a 32-year-old wife and mother of 2. I have AIDS. Please work fast. Standing ovation, first speech with the simple formula I just gave you.
As As you know, as a presenter and also a listener, an audience member, what really makes a presentation memorable, repeatable, and totally come alive is stories. Let's look at a couple of stories from one of my prior speeches. The first one is about buying a pair of pantyhose and ending up with a great salesperson, and then going to the movies with my brother in New York. Please watch not only the way we tell the stories, but what is the point of the story? You don't tell a story unless it has a message.
One morning I gave a speech for the IRS. Well, they get enough of that with money. I wanted some of those. And I was all dressed up in my business suit, and afterwards had an appointment downtown San Francisco with a gentleman who was considering hiring me to speak for his company. His secretary said, "Miss Fripp, he's just called. He's going to be half hour late. Could I get you a cup of coffee?" I said, "Thank you. I think I'll go to the store opposite, buy a pair of pantyhose." So I walked in the store and I was greeted by this dynamic, incredible, fun sales assistant. She said, "Good afternoon. Don't you look nice? How can I help you?" I said, "Oh, I just need a pair of pantyhose." She said, "I work in the shoe department. Come talk to me." I said, "I'll be honest, I have so many shoes, Imelda Marcus stops by to admire them. But I have 28 minutes, I'll come talk to you." So I wandered around, got a couple of pairs of hose, went back in the shoe department, and she was so much fun. And you know yourself, when people are fun, when people are easy to do business with, sometimes you're willing to spend a little money you hadn't expected. I thought, well, perhaps I could do with a turquoise pair of shoes. So I'm looking down, admiring my new shoes. She said, "You know, you really do look nice. What do you do?" I told her, "Well, I travel worldwide talking about good and bad customer service." She said, "I could tell the way you were dressed. You were somebody important." I thought, well, I've got about 16 more minutes. Maybe I should tell her how important. I said, "Next week I'm going to a convention of the National Speakers Association. They are going to make me their first female president." She said, "For somebody that important, do I have a dress for you?" Now I went in to kill 28 minutes and buy a pair of hose. I ended up with two pairs of hose, a pair of turquoise shoes, and an exorbitantly expensive beaded evening dress. Do you know, until I met that young woman, I had no idea I was important enough to deserve such an expensive dress. But that young woman realized what you know in the credit union movement, and that is that good customer service is exceptionally good for sales and relationships. Now let us look at what she did and how it works for us. She had what I call the schmooze factor. She was perfectly appropriate, but she was engaging, she was fun. She made an everyday interaction the highlight of the day. The schmooze factor. She also did not prejudge me by what I said. She looked at me and thought, "She's got credit cards." She also kept suggesting, which was her job, not in a pushy sales way. I didn't get the impression if I hadn't bought anything else, she would have been the slightest bit upset. But she kept suggesting. She gave me options. We always need to give our customers and members options of yeses. Now, look, I am a sales trainer. I knew what she was doing. And I loved every second of it. Because people like to be well and professionally dealt with. A few years ago, I'm in New York with my brother. We come out of a movie, it's 9:45 at night, and you know how you feel you should be sensible and go back to your hotel? But you're having such a good time, let's squeeze in one more movie. 10 minutes before, two blocks down the street, a Claude Van Damme film had just started. Well, you know, with Jean-Claude Van Damme, it doesn't really matter if you missed the beginning. It's not exactly a heavy plot. So as we're running down the street, brother's explaining the storyline to me. I said, brother, don't worry, there are 10 minutes of previews. We won't miss much. We get there 15 minutes after the movie started, or at least the advertised time. I said to the cashier, I know we're late, but we still want to come in two tickets. She said, you can't. I closed the drawer. I said, well, put the money in the drawer tomorrow. No, no, once I close up. Well, I don't know about you, but when I don't like the first answer I get, I talk to someone else. So I went to the guy who's actually taking the tickets. I said, I know we're late, we want to get in. Put the money in the drawer tomorrow. Let us in free. Keep the money yourself. He was very honest but not empowered. He called the manager. By now we went through our choices, we'd missed 20 minutes and suddenly we want to see Jean-Claude Van Damme more than our own mother. Manager says, no, we don't let in people who are late. As I was walking out, I turned around and said, you know, it's very obvious none of you here own this business. Because I always thought the number one key point in business, if people want to give you money, take it. There you had a manager, a ticket taker, and a cashier had the opportunity to bring in the business, serve the customer, increase profits. They didn't. See, they weren't working for the movie house. They weren't working for the customer. They were working for a paycheck.
There are two formulas that go into stories. Situation, solution, success is the first one. And this is great when you are giving a sales presentation. The situation is, why would a client call and say help? What is the solution? What is it your product or service actually did for the client? And then the success, the happy ever after. You can certainly use this in presentations to demonstrate, one, how satisfied clients have used your product and service, or how, in fact, the company you're talking to, their situation will change with using your product or service. We can learn so much about stories from Hollywood. The legendary screenwriting teacher Robert McKee said, stories are the creative conversion of life itself into a powerful, clearer, more meaningful experience. And then as you look at telling your stories, there's another very important formula that goes into them. This is what we call the Hollywood model. Is character dialogue, dramatic lesson learned? And this is the point with this. Your characters are flesh and blood people that your audience will emotionally relate to. So perhaps you want to just give them a backstory. Let me give you an example of this. I was speaking for LA Weight Loss, and I was suggesting to the audience who sell LA Weight Loss programs that telling stories about satisfied clients is a great way to make your colorful presentations even more interesting. I asked the audience who would like to tell me a story about the client who sent them the most business. Woman puts her hand up, comes on stage. I said, what was your client's name? She said, John. I found this fascinating because I expected weight loss clinic, it would be a woman. And then I said, what was the first thing that John said to you? Because remember, we want dialogue into your Hollywood model story. She said he walked in at 6:30 on a Friday when we're about to close and said, "Don't you dare tell anyone I was here." Ah, now isn't that dialogue even more interesting? Because one, I expected it to be a woman. Secondly, it is now intriguing to me, the audience member, that the person who sent her the most business started out saying, "Don't tell anyone I was here." And then I asked, what does John do for a living? In other words, what is his backstory? And she said, he's a fireman. Now listen to what that one word does. It is like verbal shorthand. With one word, fireman, I saw John race into a burning building, throw big guys over his shoulder. This is a manly man. Then I knew with that same one word of backstory exactly how he sold so much business. Because I have heard stories and seen in movies of firemen all in the firehouse because they have 24-hour shifts cooking dinner together. I could imagine him go in, stick out his chest and say, "Hey guys, look at this new body. You need LA weight loss." That is the power of a backstory. And that leads into, of course, the dramatic lesson learned, which is the point of the story. Because you never tell a story that doesn't have a point. So with those two formulas, hopefully you can see how we actually use the dialogue, not report on the dialogue, as you've seen in the examples. This is your Frippersize. Think of a story that you tell or would like to tell, or something that happened to you in the last week that you could use in a presentation, and then ask yourself, what is the point? Perhaps if you've got a good story and you're not sure, or even if you think it makes one point to you, practice it on your friends, at the water fountain, in a staff meeting, before it starts, at the dinner table, and then you ask your friends or family, what does that story mean to you? Because you will find there are messages beyond what you initially thought. Part of developing your storytelling ability is to just do it conversationally every day. Don't be the hero of all your stories. The first president of the National Speakers Association, Bill Gove, was a magnificent storyteller. And he often said, some speakers give you the impression they came down from the mountaintop with the tablets from God and the answers to life. It's very important you let your audience know, I didn't always know what I'm now teaching you. So that gives them hope that they can learn. In fact, if you don't do that, if you come out to, I know this, I know that, I'm an expert, it could backfire. In case you're thinking, if I followed Fripp's formula, would every speech look the same as everybody else's? Well, of course not. And you have theatrical choices. We have what I call the once upon a time technique. This means you take an incident and you start at the beginning. So let's just say you were giving a presentation about your job, whatever it is you do. And you might start at the beginning. This is what I learned. This is what happened. This is what my manager taught me. And when you develop a story or a piece of material or a presentation, I suggest you always do it in logical, chronological order. Because it's easier to remember. That isn't necessarily how you tell it. Because you can also take it begin with the end in mind. Specific example. I have a friend, Scott Halford. And we were on a program together, and it was a speaking school. And he told a story. He said, when I was a boy, I was always interested in films, and my parents encouraged me. And I went to screen school and I became a documentary filmmaker. and we had an interesting assignment where we went into death row, and I actually spent a week in solitary confinement, and I ended up sitting in Sparky, the electric chair. And then he said, Patricia, how would you tell that story? I said, I'll make do in class tomorrow. Why don't you begin at the end? And I asked him for specific details. Alfred Hitchcock said, a movie is like life with all the dull parts left out. Well, your story needs to have interesting details and leave out everything that doesn't add to the story. So I asked Scott Halford some questions. Well, when you're there, what do they actually do when you're in the electric chair? And he gave me some details. So I said, start with the end. It was the scariest day of my life. My head was shaved. The wet sponge was taped to my forehead. I was strapped into Sparky, the electric chair. Now, if you think back to the Fripp formula, what would the audience be thinking? Oh my God, what did he do? He looks so respectable. How did he get out to tell us this story? So you got the audience intrigued. So I said, Scott, start at the end, then go back to what is your logical beginning. Or the logical beginning before you got Frippnotized. When I was a young man, I was always interested in movies. I went to film school. My parents encouraged me. I became a documentary filmmaker and went to death row. So you see, it's much more intriguing and exciting for the audience if you start at the end. Then there's, and I apologize to Latin scholars, in medias res, which is start in the middle. This is what I like to call the Rambo approach. I don't know if you watch Rambo movies. If you don't, you're most deprived. Rambo 2, the opening scene, you see the back of him with his long hair and he's tying a kerchief and he turns around. He's in a monastery. He's about to fight and he gives the money to the monks. Now, theatrically, what do? This is where he is. We have to go back to the end of the last Rambo film and catch up before we go forward. And as you go to movies, I suggest you look at some of the formulas of the screenplay because many of them work for your presentation. And as you look at these formulas, just think about past, present, future. You can, with the imagine technique that you heard about, you start in the future. You might then go to the past. Come up to the present and what you have to do to paint a positive future. The very simplest way is to think, when you go to a cocktail party and you tell people you're a financial planner or you're a technology executive or a professional speaker or an image consultant or whatever you are, what are the five most frequently asked questions? At cocktail parties, what is the most common question? What do you do? And then when you tell them, they will always ask you similar questions. So let's just say your friend who's the chairman of Rotary Club called and said, hey, on Thursday our speaker just cancelled. Come talk to us about what you do for a living. All you need to do is stand up and say, the five most frequently asked questions about being a stockbroker, image consultant, professional speaker, whatever you are, and you literally read them, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And you look at one, put the notes down, and conversationally tell the audience what you said at the cocktail party. Then you pick it up, look at two. So you might say, I've never given a speech before. Yes, perhaps not. However, you said that material, those answers. And then when you've answered the five, any insights or observations you have, make them then say, before my closing remarks, are there any questions? And if you were vaguely interesting, or your subject or profession was, there will be. And then you close on whatever you think would be a great high. And then you sit down. And remember, there's no sin in finishing early. There's only a sin in taking 20 minutes too long. And then you can combine some of these formulas. I was delivering a speech called The Ups and Downs, Highs and Lows on a Way to Become a Rich and Famous Speaker to my National Speakers Association chapter. And this was just after winning the Cavett Award, which was a prestigious honor in the National Speakers Association. And I talked about this point in time. I said, July was without a doubt the most exciting month of my life. I painted the picture, said, and would you have liked that month? Most people put their hands up. I said, would you have liked that month if you realized you'd only slept in your own bed two nights? And then we go back to being born in England, young woman who was a hairdresser, get us up to date. And then I added, as a past president of the National Speakers Association, these are the questions I am most frequently asked. And so you see, that's two formulas put together. Whatever structure you choose, it's okay. Have fun with it. In fact, if you give a similar presentation over and over again, why don't you change some of the structures, not the material, just the structures, just to make it more fun for you? Because speaking is fun, and when you're having fun, your audience will enjoy it a lot more.